on this Saturday with Film Critic with Rajiv.com and Variety. Please join me in welcoming the stars of Watcher, Karl Glusman and Maika Munroe.
Probably a lot of females can relate to this just
sort of feelings, and it wasn't hard to tap into that, and Chloe really helped with all that. Yeah.
And what was it like for you? Because I think for the most part, your character actually means well. He actually means to be helpful, but also he is maybe not the best listener in the way you know, he wants to be listened to, at least. So what was it like for you trying to understand this guy and to kind of navigate that character?
Well, you sort of encounter similar characters in when you're reading scripts and plays. Actually, this guy kind of reminded me of a character which I had read previously. It was actually from the Glass Menagerie. It was this character, the gentleman caller. And when I look at a role, I tend to try to boil it down to a very simple statement for myself. I don't like to get too cerebral about parts. And the gentleman caller, to me, was a guy who meant well, but was a bit clumsy. And actually, Francis seems similar to me, where he means well, but he can be a bit clumsy. I myself have been guilty of this in relationships where your partner is going through something and all you want to do is fix it. And sometimes trying to fix it is not actually the answer. Sometimes the best response you can have with your partner is to just listen. And I've learned this mistake, and I've learned it with pain, which I'm now grateful for. But this was something I wanted to illuminate, which was something that I've done. It's a shortcoming. It's your partner is experiencing something, and you just want to make it better. And actually, sometimes by trying to minimize and tell them that it's not a problem, you actually make it worse, because then you're not actually seeing your partner. And that was sort of the part for me.
And yes.
Thank you.
And I have to say, you two have such a believable married couple chemistry on screen. Yeah, that's obviously a loving relationship, but there's also some grudge kind of brewing underneath slowly that comes out. I'm wondering how you guys established that. Did you do any kind of backstory exercises? I mean, you're an ex-actress in the movie. Did you talk about that? Did you talk about your history? What was it like?
Yeah, we had rehearsals for maybe, felt like a decent amount of time for a small little movie. I feel like for maybe a week here or there, a week before. But on top of that, we were also, it was COVID times, so we're all staying at a hotel together. Carl and I and one of my good friends who came with me, we had like a floor to ourselves, only because they had to block out literally the floor for COVID reasons. And so we just became so close, like we just hang out all the time and got to know each other so well. And I think that you don't always get that with indie movies. You don't get the time to rehearse. But I think, yeah, I don't know, COVID, I think maybe helped in that way. Because if it wasn't there, maybe we'd all be like in different apartments and Airbnbs, but we were all just kind of like stuck in this hotel together. And forced to, not forced, but like we were, eating there, drinking there, everything was there for the stages. And so, yeah, I think that it is a part of me that's like, I think it actually really helped with all of it.
Was that like that for you as well?
Yeah, I mean, the unfortunate part of our experience was when you get to be a traveling salesman and you get to go to a new city, a new country, one of the coolest things you can do is interact with people that you don't know, locals. We didn't get any of that, really, so on the 13th floor of the Marriott in Bucharest.
Absolutely, it was fun.
I think everyone here would agree with me, Maika, I love your wardrobe in this movie so much. It's beautiful, but it's also very, there's something very Hitchcockian about it. You know, it's very minimalist, very effortlessly chic. It's in line with your character, but it's also in line with this genre. I'm wondering if wearing those clothes informed any part of the performance.
Yeah, I always think clothing is such So Chloe had actually, she sent me this lookbook or the wardrobe blended sentence kind of lookbook of what she was thinking. And I kind of like, yeah, I think I had this other idea. And I was like, okay, Chloe, hear me out. Hear me out. And we kind of like talked it through, and I sent her, we kind of went back and forth sending a bunch of images. And I kind of wanted to, yeah, we came to this idea of beginning with really bright colors and the reds and the oranges, and then slowly kind of taking that away. And so as the character becomes more and more uncomfortable, she's trying to hide from, you know, when you meet her, she's more confident and outgoing. And anyways, I think it was really fun to, it was one of my favorite parts, honestly. I think it, yeah, was really helpful in creating this character, so.
Can I also ask you about working with Vernon Borman, specifically about, you know, because it's such this delicate cat and mouse game and it's very intense. What was it like on set? Did you guys have to keep distance from each other in order to not break that intensity? How was that?
No, Vern is so nice. So charming and nice. Let's dance.
Right in here.
Yeah, loves playing music and dancing and singing. It's the best. But then as soon as you walk on set, he completely transformed. And both Chloe and I, we had been shooting for, I don't know, probably, I mean, yeah, a couple weeks at that point by the time Bert, maybe 3 weeks, we're almost near the end when Bert came. And we didn't really know what to expect. And he was so lovely and nice, and we're like, oh my god, okay. And then the first stuff they were shooting was on the train, which is super intense.
Yes.
And yeah, he just completely transformed his body language, the way he walked, the accent, everything. It was just like so incredible to see. So yeah, it was really such a blast to work with him.
I can't believe you started with the train scene, because in the movie that's such an earned intensity, and to start with that must have been really hard.
Indie movies. Like, we have no control. Yeah, no, it was crazy.
So since we're talking about them, let's talk about the end scene a little bit, because it has such this amazing both psychological and physical choreography there that must have been really difficult to pull off. I love the surprise reaction you give to the gunshots. You know, we almost, you know, felt like that was real. So do you remember shooting that scene and how intense it was? That must have been probably one of the trickiest ones.
Yeah. I mean, for me, all the stuff building up to that, I was shot for about 3 days,
mm-hmm.
And then all that last stuff, yeah, it was very intense.
Yeah, and you trying to anticipate what's going to happen. I mean, you've read the script, you know what's going to happen, you know what you're doing in the scene, but even something so technical and like reactionary is like fake blood splatter, you know, you're trying to anticipate this thing hitting you in the face. I mean, that's what I remember, just trying to be relaxed and to just take it moment by moment. And it's really wacky too. I mean, we're shooting like full cartridges. Like,
I just really love the "I told you so" look that you have on your face. I know.
Francis is the worst.
Talk about giving us that reaction. I mean, because that face is such a perfect timing. You don't want to see anything else in the movie after you see that.
Well, I remember, getting to the end of the script. I just loved the end so much. I was like, it's just done. The movie's just done. And I knew that this final look was going to be very important. And honestly, like, Chloe, the way that, yeah, we just, like, would talk, we like, do a take, and she'd be like, okay, let's try, like, this, let's see, you know, think about this when you turn to look at him. And it was, I don't know, it was so fun to, like, play around. I mean, it'd be very interesting to see all the different takes. We probably did, I don't know, seven, eight takes, and kind of did, anyways, maybe you weren't there because
though, right?
Definitely.
But even like the way it was written.
Yes.
Actually,
yes.
I remember now there was a rewrite and a new ending.
Totally.
It's not what the original script said.
You're correct.
There was no gun.
It was, oh God, I can't remember.
I think you stabbed his ass. Not his ass. Good.
Either way, I got him. I mean, the great energy we see here is, you know, obviously very real because you two are going to be in another movie together very soon. And I
yes.
Is there anything you can tell us about that? Despite the cast already.
Yeah, I mean, it couldn't be more polar opposite than this. Karl is a, well, I guess you're kind of a villain. He's not a villain.
No, it's a completely different film, completely different characters. Our dynamic couldn't be more different. It's so fun, actually.
Yeah.
It's so fun. You spend so much time with someone, and then suddenly, like, the roles
yeah.
change, and you're like, each other, like, oh.
You're like, it's a whole brand new game.
Yeah, I have
here.
Some of the power now. Old friend.
I can't wait to see that turn with the table. So, a few questions from the audience. Very bright, I'll try to see your hands. Yes.
Karl, I was wondering, did you and Floyd work at all on your character, like being red herring of a threat to Mike's character?
Did anyone hear the question whether you and Floyd worked together on you being a red herring?
It was definitely part of the conversation, which was, you know, as an audience member when you watch this film, who do we track and who do we think, being in the headspace with Maika's character, who do we think the spider might be? When I watch it, there's times when I think, oh man, I could have put in a moment there where, you know, maybe I would have been more suspicious. Yeah, I just have to trust that what happened was what was supposed to happen, and the filmmaker, cut together the movie they wanted to make and just give them all the options they have for the editing room. But we definitely talked about beat by beat, who might this character might think was the threat throughout. And to me, when I watch it, it's great that the biggest surprise is that it's actually the person that it's obviously might be the whole time. I love that. It doesn't feel predictable in that way to me when I watch it. So.
It's true. It's about trusting your intuition. Sometimes the most obvious answer if you're feeling that is the correct one. Let's take another one. Yes, right there.
What was your most memorable bit of direction from Chloe?
The most memorable bit of direction from Chloe.
Alright. Honestly, probably, we were just kind of talking about it, the last shot, I feel like we really wanted to get it, or maybe we didn't know what we wanted it to be until Chloe got into the editing room, but I think it would be quite cool actually to see all the different takes because I think they were quite different. It could really have a different feeling, and so I don't know, that was probably one of my favorite moments. There's so many, but that's probably one of my favorites. Yeah.
Carl, do you have one memorable bit of direction from Chloe?
I mean, honestly, like, I also remember, now that we're talking about it, I do remember that last scene a lot. It was so loud because of the squibs and, the blanks and stuff they were shooting on burn. But, I just remember, like, my close-up, we were sort of like, when you're shooting these indie movies, time is money. You don't get to necessarily come back to the location you're shooting in every time. So sometimes it's like what we get right now is what we're working with. And I do remember when we did get to my close-up, just sort of how, focused we had to be and time was sort of running out. And I just remember how sensitive that moment felt with, like, this realization and seeing started to question this whole time and like really started like wonder, are they all there? Are they okay? Like they're really like losing it, going through all this thing, all this stuff. And then that I told you so moment was sort of like catching that, you know, taking in the someone getting shot in the hallway and then going to Maika and then her look to me. And Maika was there to give me the look off camera. I told you so. Francis is the worst.
I think we have time for a couple more, probably. Can I see any hands? Very right. Rehearsal is absolutely valuable. You might not get as much time as when you do a theater production where you get to rehearse for and block it for a month, but if you have any time whatsoever, it's just, I love it. I love to rehearse. I want to try stuff that's nonverbal, the behavior in between the lines. You don't always get to do that, but when you do, it is a gift. And I can't, I mean, if your performers are, you know, it's not going to go stale trying, you know, practicing stuff or at least marking it out, kind of feeling it out. Like it's valuable. It's valuable time. It's precious time. It's a great note to end the conversation on. Thank you, Maika.
Thank you.